all generations. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you today for your grace and your love toward us. And we gather wherever we are in many different rooms and offices and wherever we may be, we gather together by way of the internet to worship you, to sing your praises, to glorify your name, to praise you for who you are and for the mighty works that you have accomplished. And Lord, we know that you know all that is happening in our world, the struggles that each individual faces. And Lord, we come to you today and we just place our needs, our burdens, our heartaches, our joys, our sorrows, our hopes, our dreams into your hands. And we pray, dear Lord, that you would work in a way to bring about your will and your glory. Be with us in this time of worship. May you use the songs and the prayers and the testimonies, the praise of your word, the message today. May it all work together to bring you glory and to encourage the people of God. And we pray, dear Lord, that as we share your word today, that there would be people somewhere who would turn to Jesus and ask Jesus to be their Savior and to make a decision to follow him. And we'll give you praise for all that you do. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
You hear me when I call, you are my morning song. Though darkness fills the night, it cannot hide the light. Whom shall I fear? You crush the enemy underneath my feet. You are my sword and shield. Though troubles linger still, whom shall I fear? I know who goes before me. I know who stands behind. The God of angel armies is always by my side. The one who reigns forever, he is a friend of mine. The God of is always by my side. My strength is in your name, for you alone can save. You will deliver me, yours is the victory. Who shall I be? Forever. He is a friend of mine. The God of angel armies is always by my side. I know who goes before me. I know who stands behind. The God of angel armies is always by my side. The one who reigns forever, he is a friend of mine. The God of angel armies is always by my side. The God of angel armies is always by my side. Hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest rain, but wholly trust in Jesus' name. Hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest rain, but wholly trust in Jesus' name. Christ alone, cornerstone, we made strong in the Savior's love. Through the storm, He is Lord, Lord of all. When darkness seems to hide His face, I rest on His unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, I anchor hope within the veil. I anchor hope within the veil. Christ alone, strong in the Savior's love. Through the storm, He is Lord, Lord of all. He is Lord, Lord of all. Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior's love. Through the storm, He is Lord, Lord of all. Christ alone, cornerstone, and He shall come with trumpet sound. Oh, may I then in Him be found. dressed in his righteousness alone, faultless to stand before the throne. You give life, you are love, you bring light to the darkness, you give hope, you restore every heart that is broken, and great are you, Lord. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise, we pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise to you only. You give life, you are love, you bring light to the darkness, you give hope, you restore every heart that is broken, and great are you, Lord. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise, we pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise to you only. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise, we pour out. In our lungs, so we pour out our praise to you only. And all the earth will shout your praise, our hearts will cry, these bones will sing, great are you, Lord. And all the earth will shout your praise, our hearts will cry, these bones will sing, great are you, Lord. And all the earth will shout your praise, our hearts will cry, these bones will sing, great are you, Lord. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise, pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise to you only. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise, we pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise to you all.
Great is thy faithfulness. Great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me.
Well, here we are. We find ourselves in the midst of the COVID-19 virus, which has disrupted all of our lives, has sickened millions of people, and has taken nearly 200,000 lives around the world. And I believe today that if there was just one treatment, if there was one cure, one pill, one vaccine that would be able to take care of this virus and wipe it from the face of the earth and we never had to worry about it again, I think the whole world would rejoice at such a cure. Well, the world is also held in the grips of another global pandemic that is called sin. It has infected every person who has been born into this world, except for Jesus Christ, since the first couple, Adam and Eve. We are genetic carriers of this disease. We pass it on to our children, and they pass it on to their children, generation after generation. The scripture tells us that we have all sinned and fall short of the glory of God. And again, the scripture tells us that the wages of sin is death. Sin is a deadly disease that affects everyone in the world. Today I want to talk to you about the one and only cure for this global pandemic called sin. It is the one and only thing that separates us from our Creator, our Heavenly Father. And just as we would celebrate just one cure for COVID-19, we should rejoice in the goodness and the grace of God in providing a cure for the terrible pandemic of sin. We're continuing our series today called Jesus Is, and today we're going to look at the statement that Jesus made, I am the way, the truth, and the life. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. And I'm going to look at these three phrases backwards. We're going to start with the life and work our way back to the way. First of all, Jesus is the life. And at Easter, we talked about him being the resurrection and the life. And he is the source of our physical life. In Colossians chapter 1, verse 16, it says, for in him all things were created, things in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or powers or rulers or authority, all things have been created through him and for him. Everything in the universe finds its source in Jesus Christ, including you and I. The very breath that we breathe that was just sung about, we receive our breath from God and we use our breath to praise him. Our physical life, this is something that comes to every person who comes into the world, whether we believe in him or do not believe in him, whether we live for him or don't live for him, every human being finds their source of life in Jesus Christ. All things have been created through him and for him. But beyond that, Jesus tells us that not only do we have a physical life, but that he came into the world to give us a full life, an abundant life. In John's Gospel, chapter 10, verse 10, Jesus says, the thief only comes to steal and kill and destroy. I have come that they might have life and have it to the full. There's one thing to be able to be a human being and to have breath and to be able to have life. But so many people find life to be meaningless. And even in Ecclesiastes, the wise man, Solomon, said he searched everything and everything was vanity. Everything was hollow and empty. But when Jesus came, he came to give us meaning to our life. He came to fulfill our lives and to give us a purpose to live. He came that we might have it to the full. And there are some people who have become acquainted with the gospel. They know the gospel, and they heard about Jesus and how he came and lived on earth and taught and performed miracles and died on the cross for our sins and was buried and rose again. They know all of that, and yet they don't turn to Jesus because they're afraid of what they're going to have to give up. They're afraid of what they're going to miss. If they follow Jesus and they live for Jesus and they sacrifice in their own life, they focus on what they might miss out on or what they might have to give up. But Jesus gives us more than what we would ever give up for him. He came to give us life to the full. And while people are trying to find meaning in all kinds of different ways, life just comes up meaningless outside of Jesus Christ. But Jesus came to give us life to the full. So we have physical life in Jesus. Jesus is the life. He gives us physical life. He gives us full life. He gives us a meaningful life, a purpose in life, a purpose for living. And he also gives us eternal life. In Romans chapter 5, verse 17, the Apostle Paul writes, "For if by the trespass of the one man death reigned through that one man, how much more will those who receive God's abundant provision of grace and of the gift of righteousness reign in life through this one man, Jesus Christ?" I mentioned in the introduction that we pass this pandemic of sin from one generation to the other, and we can trace this all the way back to the Garden of Eden. The first man and the first woman that God created sinned and disobeyed God, and sin came into the world. And in Genesis chapter 3, we see where the curse came upon the man and the woman and upon the world at that time. And generation after generation after generation, we pass that curse of sin on to our families. And the wages of sin is death, as we mentioned. But Jesus came just as death passed from one generation to another, passed from one man on to all human beings. In the same way, God's abundant provision of grace and the gift of righteousness reign in life through the one man, Jesus Christ. He gives us eternal life, that there's hope beyond the grave. We've all been touched by death, and to think of the hundreds of thousands of people who have died just in the last 6 to 8 weeks because of this pandemic, and to think about family members who have died. My heart goes out to families whose family members have died in recent weeks, and they couldn't visit in the hospital, or they couldn't visit in the nursing home, and they couldn't go to the funeral home and conduct a service or have a service in the church. And even family members, close family members, could not even go to the cemetery because of the limitations of gatherings of only 10. But we have hope beyond physical death. He came to give us eternal life. And so when Jesus says, "I am the life," he is the source of our physical life. He is the source of full and abundant life, a meaningful life, a purposeful life. And he is the source of eternal life. He gives us the hope that beyond this world and beyond the grave, that we will live with him eternally. Last Sunday, we talked about heaven, and we talked about how God will wipe all tears from our eyes, and we'll be in that place where there'll be no more death or mourning or sickness or pain. And God will be our God, and we will be His people. And He has come to provide that for us. He is the life. Jesus said not only that, but He said, I am the truth. I am the truth. All of my life, and I'm over 60 years old, and so I've lived it over more than six decades. And all of my life, there has been a war on the truth. You can go back and you can trace through the various decades of the last half of the 20th century and into the 21st century, and you can see the battle against truth. And we've come to a time that people refer to as the postmodern era, where truth is rejected. People spend hundreds of thousands of dollars to send their children to college and universities to find out that there is no truth. Well, what are they teaching if there is no truth? Are they teaching a lie? Are they teaching a falsehood? Many people believe that there is no truth and that you can't know truth, that whatever you think is truth for you, but it's not truth for everyone else. But Jesus said, I am the truth. And in John chapter 8, verses 31 and 32, it says there, to the Jews who had believed him, Jesus said, if you hold to my teaching, you are really my disciples. Then you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free. Jesus is indicating that there is truth, and that his teachings are the truth. His words are truth. And this goes along with the idea of meaninglessness and purposelessness that we find. So many people are living without purpose in their life. And that's because they have no truth. There's nothing to base their life upon. And Jesus said, I am the truth. Many believe that there is no truth, that you cannot know the truth. But in John chapter 17, verse 17, in the greatest prayer probably that has ever been prayed, Jesus prayed this prayer just before going to the cross. On the night before his crucifixion, he was with his disciples, and he prayed this prayer of John 17, 17, and he says to the Father, sanctify them by the truth. Your word is truth. And Jesus is the living word. And so Scripture is the truth. The words of Jesus is the truth. Jesus himself is the truth. And I want to say to you today that even in this postmodern era, this second decade into the third decade now of the 20th century, there is still truth, and Jesus is the truth. And if you're discouraged and you can't find purpose in your life and you can't find meaning in your life, I want to encourage you today to find the truth in Jesus and to find the truth in God's Word. You will know the truth, and the truth will set you free. In the midst of this sinful pandemic, this sin pandemic, you can find truth in Jesus. And then the third thing that we want to notice that Jesus said, he said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. We want to look at the way. Jesus is the way. Last week we talked about that Jesus is going to prepare a place for us. And then he said that we know the way. And the disciples asked the question, we don't even know where you're going. How can we know the way? And this verse that we're looking at this morning is the response to that. I am the way, the truth, and the life. You can find your way through Jesus. And the search for a cure for COVID-19 is underway now. And there may be a variety of different things that will be discovered that will help us deal with that in the future. But there is one cure for sin. There's only one way to cure sin. In Matthew chapter 7, verses 13 and 14, Jesus said, enter through the narrow gate, for wide is the gate, and broad is the road that leads to destruction, and many enter through it, but small is the gate, and narrow the road that leads to life, and only a few find it. There is only one way. It's a narrow way. It's by placing your faith in Jesus. He is the way. There's a saying from the Roman Empire that all roads lead to Rome. And there are many who have taken that philosophy that all roads lead to heaven, that it doesn't matter what you believe, it doesn't matter what religion you practice or who you follow, as long as you're sincere, you're going to go to heaven. Well, that doesn't kind of work out in the world. You know, there are laws of nature, and I can believe all that I want to, that I can walk out in front of a truck moving at 55 miles an hour, and that I can live through it. But whether, no matter how sincerely I believe that, once I step out in front of the truck, I'm dead. It's over. You know, I could believe that I could climb up on the roof of this church building or in my home and think that I can defy gravity. And if I really believe it, that I can go up and not down. No matter how sincerely I believe that, once my feet leave that roof, I'm going down. Okay, I might go up a little bit from the energy that I put into the jump, but I'm coming down. And the same is true with our philosophies and our ways of thinking. Jesus said there's only one way, and He is the only way that we can go to the Father. And so no matter how sincerely we believe other things, we need to realize that Jesus is the only way to the Father. In John chapter 10, verse 9, Jesus said, "I am the gate. Whoever enters through me will be saved. They will come in and go out and find pasture." And in our scripture today, in John 14, 6, Jesus said, "No one comes to the Father except through me." Rather than rejoicing in the grace of God and entering through the way that God has provided for us to escape the penalty of this terrible pandemic that we have called sin, many say, well, that isn't fair. That isn't right. We should be able to choose any way that we want to. But the reality is there's only one way to come into relationship with God the Father. There's only one way to follow Jesus to that place where He has gone to prepare for us, and that is through Jesus Christ. Any other way you choose will take you away from the Father rather than to the Father. And we must accept that. And we should rejoice in the one way. Professional singer Ruth Anna Metzger tells of a time when she was invited to sing at a wedding of a very wealthy man. And she and her husband received an invitation to go to the reception that followed that, and it was going to be held on the top two floors of Seattle's Columbia Tower, the Northwest tallest skyscraper. And she and her husband, Roy, were both excited about being able to attend this wonderful event. And after the wedding was over, they traveled there to the Columbia Tower Hotel and went up. And on the second to the top floor, they had hors d'oeuvres prepared. And the waiters were wearing tuxedos and serving them. And then at the appropriate time, someone came and cut the ribbon that was on the glass and brass steps that go up to the top floor where the main banquet was going to be. And the bride and groom ascended the steps, and then the guests went up the steps. And at the top of the steps, there was a maitre d' with a book, and it had the names of all the people who had sent in their RSVPs. And as they would go up, they'd give their name. He would check them off and say, yes, you would go, and one of the waiters would take them and find their seats for them, and they would have that opportunity to do that. Well, when the Metzgers came up, Ruth Anna said, my name is Ruth Anna Metzger, and my husband, Roy, And the maitre d' looked at the list and their names were not there. And they tried several times and they spelled their name. And they said, well, look under Roy. Maybe it's Roy and not under Ruth Anna. And the maitre d' finally said, you cannot enter. Your name is not in the book. And Ruth Anna said, I'm a singer and I just sang at the wedding. And the maitre d' said, I don't care who you are or what you just did, you are not allowed to go in if your name is not in this book. Because it was only the people in the book that preparations had been made for. Only the people who had sent in their RSVP and had their name in the book had a place at the table. And so the maitre d' called for a waiter to come over and ask the waiter to lead them over to the service elevator and to take them to the parking garage. And so they followed this waiter, and as they went by, they noticed all these waiters in their glamorous white tuxedos. They passed tables full of beautiful food, and everyone was chatting and laughing and enjoying themselves in preparation for this great banquet. And they were taken through and over to the service elevator, and they went down to the garage and went out and found their car in silence. They drove for quite a while in silence, and finally Roy broke the silence and said to Ruth Anna, what just happened? And she began to break down and cry. She said, when the invitation came, I saw that there was an RSVP, but I was busy. And I thought it really didn't matter because I was singing at the wedding. And I thought certainly that they would let the singer into the reception. She said, and began to cry, we just missed the most beautiful reception that we will ever be invited to. And that's the same thing that's going to happen to many people. Last week we talked about the Lamb's Book of Life, and those whose names are written in the Lamb's Book of Life will be able to enter into the kingdom of God. Those who do not have their names there will be thrown into the lake of fire with Satan and those who serve him. And you know, there are people today who just say, I'm too busy to serve Jesus. And anyway, I was raised in a Christian family. My parents were pastors. I grew up on the mission field. I go to church. I serve at church. I give to my church. Certainly, God's going to let me in. I'm a good person. I never hurt anybody. I've done a lot of things to help people. But Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except by me. You don't get into heaven because of who your parents are. You don't get into heaven because of the way you were raised. You don't get into heaven because of the good works that you do and the people that you help or the money that you give. There is only one way to heaven, and that is through a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. There are many people who thought that they were going to spend eternity in heaven, who got there and found that their names were not written in the Lamb's Book of Life. And every person who is listening to this video today has an opportunity. You're still alive. You're still breathing. You still have the ability to choose. And I want to encourage you today to choose to follow Jesus. He is the only way. He is the only truth. He is the only source of life for each of us. If we choose any other path, if we choose any other way, we will not come to the Father. Jesus said, no one comes to the Father but by me. And I encourage you today to turn to Jesus and ask Jesus to be your Savior. I'm going to pray a prayer right now. of confession and repentance. And wherever you are, if you'll just take this moment to stop whatever you're doing and listen and pray and ask Jesus to be your Savior, you can become a follower of Jesus today and know that your sins are forgiven and that you can have a place in heaven. Let's pray. Dear Jesus, I confess that I'm a sinner. I was born in sin, and I've committed acts of sin and rebellion against you. I've thought many times that I'm good enough, but I recognize today that the only way to heaven is by you. And so today I repent. I change my mind. I turn around. I turn away from my sin, and I turn to you, Jesus, and I ask you to forgive my sin and to restore me into a right relationship with God the Father. And today, in the middle of this COVID-19 virus pandemic, I choose to become a follower of Jesus Christ. Lord, I pray that you would answer this prayer for every person who prays it, for your glory and for your honor. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. If you just prayed that prayer, we encourage you to let us know so that we can follow up with you. If you're watching on Facebook, just make a comment and tell us that you asked Jesus to be your Savior today and you became a follower of Jesus today. If you go to our website or to the YouTube page, send a message to us and let us know this so that we can celebrate with you and give you some helps to follow up after today. I want to close the service this morning with a prayer that comes from the YouVersion Bible app, and it's a prayer for the frontliners, the people who are on the front lines of this COVID-19 virus. We want to pray for them before we finish up today. Father, thank you for those caring for and serving our communities. Thank you for servant leaders who daily risk their health and safety for others. Please protect them, Lord. Give them courage and strength, and let them feel your presence as they are working. Provide all that they need to serve others and provide for their loved ones. Send people to help and support them and their families. You said we would have troubles, but you have overcome this world. Please work together with our frontliners to bring about the best possible outcome. In Jesus' name, amen.